This is not the destination. Remind my soul to start recalling. This is just a hallway on my way home. As I remember the promise of a love unending. Jesus, no, I'm never failing. Even in the madness, I was fixed on home. I can't wait one day I finally arrive, where there's no hurt or pain. Endless praise poured out to the infinite God, singing with angels and saints. Holy, holy, are you Lord Almighty? Nothing between us, the grandeur of our heaven's colors. Caught within this awestruck wonder,
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. Cause I know there's peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break. Declaring there is hope and there is freedom, I speak Jesus. 'Cause your name is power, your name is healing, your name is love. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows. Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Jesus, over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Speak Jesus. Speak Jesus over cancer. Speak Jesus over heart. Jesus in your finances. Speak Jesus in your marriage. Jesus. Speak Jesus over everything. We trust you, Lord. We speak Jesus. We speak Jesus. Shout Jesus
on the mountains. Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family. I speak the holy name. Jesus.
Shout Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountains. Jesus in the streets.
I do appreciate you all being here tonight. I'm going to continue this evening through the book of Revelation talking about the seven churches, the seven churches. Tonight we're on church number five, number five. If you read in the book of Revelation in chapter 2 and go right on into chapter 3, I've made mention of this before just to do a quick review. You're going to see that there's these seven letters written to seven churches. Seven in the Bible is a number that means completion. And these seven letters are written to these seven churches, and these letters come from Jesus Christ himself, and they're given to the Apostle John. We know the Apostle John. He was a close follower of Jesus Christ. He loved the Lord, and the Lord loved the Apostle John. And because of the Apostle John's faith and his boldness and his testimony, and because he was a preacher of the Word of God, he was persecuted through the Roman Empire, and he was placed on a prison island called the Island of Patmos. That's really the setting there in the book of Revelation. And it was in that dark time in the Apostle John's life that the Lord came to him and gave him a word. How many of you are grateful tonight when we go through dark times, the Lord will come to us and give us a word? Amen. He will. And that's what he did for the Apostle John. He came to him and gave him these seven letters that were to be delivered to these seven churches. And he gives each one of these churches, these seven churches, a different letter. You know why? Because every church is different. Every church is different. Our church is different than a church in another city away from here. Our church is different than the church over in another country. Every church is different. But remember this, the Lord knows the details of every church. Amen. And in these letters here that Jesus had written, he sends this message to these churches, and he is taking time in these letters commending these churches, but he's also taking time to correct these churches for whatever reason. You know, the Lord will, he will correct you. He will discipline you, if you know what I'm talking about. And he uses these letters here to commend these churches, to affirm these churches, but he also uses these letters to correct them. And the reason he's having to correct these churches, I want to give you a news flash tonight. I reminded you this just a few weeks ago. The reason why he's having to correct them is because there's no perfect church. There is no perfect church. And the reason why the church is not perfect is because it's made up of people. Amen. There's no perfect pastor. There's no perfect staff. There's no perfect counsel. There's no perfect deacon or elder. There's no perfect ministry leader. There's no perfect singers or musicians. There's no perfect church member. There's no perfect church. But we serve the one who is perfect, and his name is Jesus. Amen. Can we say amen to that? Amen. He's perfect. Amen. He's perfect, and his will is perfect. Well, tonight, this church that we're going to take the next few minutes and just kind of dive into some things here and let the Lord speak to our hearts. We can make some application to ourselves that we're going to look at tonight. This church is called Sardis. Say Sardis. Sardis. Now, this church, Sardis, was definitely not a perfect church. They had their own problems for sure, like all churches. They had problems. And let's read this letter here that was written to the church in Sardis. It's found in Revelation chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. You can mark that in your Bible and maybe go back and read it some over the next few days and get some more. Now, amen. Praise the Lord. Revelation chapter 3. To the angel of the church in Sardis, write, these are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. That's Jesus talking about himself. He always opens up these letters describing himself in some special way. He says, these are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. He says, I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you're dead. Wake up. Strengthen what remains and is about to die. For I have not found your deeds complete in the sight of my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard, and obey it and repent. Some translations say, what you have received and heard, hold to it and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. In other words, Jesus is telling them, there's going to be a time if you don't repent and change your ways, there's going to be a day I'm going to come and I'm going to judge you. And in verse 4 it says, yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. They will walk with me dressed in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes will, like them, be dressed in white. I will never blot out his name from the book of life, but will acknowledge his name before my Father and his angels. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Lord, we have ears tonight. And Lord, we know you want to say something to this church and to our own lives personally. And we pray, Lord, tonight that our ears would be opened spiritually and we would be receptive to what you want to say and speak into our lives tonight. God, may your perfect will be done in the name of Jesus. Amen, amen. So what can we learn tonight from the church in Sardis? Well, the first thing that we can learn is that the church in Sardis was a sleeping church. They were a sleeping church. Let me just remind you, and I'm just pulling some verses here. Jesus reminds the church in Sardis, like he reminded all the other churches. He tells them, he says, I see everything that you're doing. I know this church in Sardis. I'm walking through your church, and I see everything, and I know everything. Jesus is saying, I see it all, and I know it all. You know why? He says here in verse 1, he says, I know your deeds. He says, I know your deeds. He's looking at that church, and you know who the church is, right? The church is you, and the church is me. He says, I'm looking at you, and I know your deeds. I know your preaching. I know your prayer life. I know your devotional life. I know how you treat one another. I know your motives. I know your heart. Jesus is telling this church, he says, listen to me. I know your deeds. You might be able to fool those around you, but he's saying you will never fool me because I know it all and I see it all. I see everything and nothing is hidden from me. And that's what Jesus is declaring to this church. And he says to them, I know your deeds. And he says this, because I know your deeds, I know that you have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wow. Man, that's powerful words there coming from the Lord speaking to his church. He says, you have, I know your deeds, and you have a reputation of being a live church, but you are dead. Now, I want you to notice this now, because if you look at all the other churches up to this point, a majority of them had allowed false teaching to creep into the church, into the pulpit, into teaching. But this is not the case here with this church. They're not being rebuked because someone's standing behind the pulpit and preaching something other than Jesus, another kind of Jesus, another kind of gospel, as Paul would say. They're not standing behind the pulpit with a false teaching. The church in Sardis is really a church that had a solid and sound Bible preaching and teaching. I mean, the word of God was being proclaimed in that church. The doctrine was not the problem. The problem was is they had a reputation of being alive, but really they were dead. The word of God was being preached. It was taught all throughout the church, but that was not the problem. The problem was they had the reputation that they were alive in Christ, but really they were dead on the inside. Now, when you study this letter here and look and research some things in that city there of Sardis, during that time, this church here had a great reputation in their community. This church had a great reputation of being a church that was on fire. It was a reputation of a church being alive. But let me just say this to you tonight. How many of you know right now this evening that reputation, your reputation doesn't necessarily mean reality in your life? Just because it's your reputation doesn't necessarily mean it's a reality in your life. And Jesus said to this church, you have a great reputation. You have a great reputation in the community of being a church that is alive, but the reality is you're dead. The reality is you're dead. The reality is that you're dying spiritually day by day. And we live in a world today. Come on, I know you're going to shout me down on this. We live in a day today that most people are more concerned about their reputation than they are reality. That's why a lot of people are in debt today. They want to project some kind of reputation, but they reject the reality that they don't have no money, but they put everything on a credit card because they want to hold up a reputation. Well, you can say amen if you want to. People today are more concerned about what other people think about them. People today are more concerned about how other people feel about them. Isn't that the truth? We live in that kind of culture today where people are just so concerned about how they look in front of people and how they're viewed in front of people and how they appear to people. And that's why I believe, and I'm getting on my soapbox here just for a minute, that's why I believe that Facebook is so popular in social media. Because on Facebook, people can build up a reputation and it's there, but it's not a reality. They build up something on Facebook that's a reputation, but it's not a reality. That's why I call it Fakebook instead of Facebook. You know what happens? People are trying to build their reputation, and they build their reputation on how many likes they have or how many views they have. And it's a false kind of security there that's hopefully going to put out some kind of reputation, but it's not the reality in their life. And I could go on and on about that. But here's what Jesus was saying to this church. He's saying, listen, all you're concerned about right now is you're trying to post some stuff out there to get you some views and get you some likes, and you're trying to create some kind of reputation that you're alive and you're living. He said, but the reality is you're dead. And he's telling this church, he says, listen, what really matters is not what other people think about you. What really matters is not what people see about you. Jesus said to this church, he said, what really matters is this. I see you and I see your heart, and the reality is I see that you're dead. The reality is you're dying spiritually. The reality is that you're sleeping spiritually. Now, when you study that word dead in the Bible there, and put it there in the context of what Jesus was saying in this letter, that word dead, it means to be asleep. You remember many times in the Bible we're warned to be alert, stay awake, right? Stay awake, be alert. And Jesus is saying here, you're dead. And what he was saying is you're sleeping. Sardis, you're a sleeping church. In other words, you're a lifeless church. You have no passion, you have no fire, you have no fervor, you have no zeal for the Lord. I mean, you look good on the outside, and when the community looks at you, you look alive, but when I look at your heart, I see no passion, no fire, no fervor, no zeal at all for the Lord. And Jesus said, church, you're a sleeping church, and you need to do what? You need to wake up. He says, you need to wake up. How many of you know there's churches today, all of us, we all need to wake up, amen? How many of you know tonight that churches can die spiritually? Do you hear me? Churches can die spiritually. Did you realize in this area here in Revelation, it was in the Bible, it would have been Asia, but we call it Turkey today. These seven churches, do you know there's really hardly any Christian influence there at all, anymore at all? You have seven powerful churches there at one time in history, and there's no longer any influence there. Why? Because they died spiritually. And it can happen to any church. It can happen to Mount Olive First Pentecostal Holiness Church. It can happen to you. It can happen to our church. It can happen to any church. How many of you know that Christians can fall asleep spiritually? And Jesus warned the church. He warned this church here. He said, listen, you're asleep, you're dead, and you need to wake up. I know there's a reputation in the community that you're alive. There's a reputation that you're alive because of all your programs that you have going on, because of all your ministries, men's ministry, women's ministry. You got so many ministries going on. There's a reputation that you're alive because you're doing outreaches in the community. There's a reputation because you're a giving church. There's a reputation because of all the activity and the busyness we see. But Jesus said, listen, but on the inside, where the heart is, you're dead. And he says, you need to wake up. You need to wake up. And I'll be the first to tell you, friend, there are churches today that need to wake up. There are church people today that need to wake up. Christians sleeping and lifeless in praise and worship time. I see it. No one should have to stand on stage and pump and prime anybody to praise the Lord. You should walk in and say, I'm ready to give my Jesus praise today. Amen. I see it. People up here on stage and they're under the anointing of the Holy Spirit and singing and giving God glory and leading us. And some people out there, like, right here, not engaged one bit at all. lifeless, dead spiritually. Christians sleeping and lifeless during prayer time, taking our voices and crying out to God, believing God to move. And some people are already checked out and they're already doing something that they've got planned for tomorrow in their mind and they're not even focused on praying. Christians sleeping and lifeless in preaching time. Oh, I see that one all the time. Some of y'all sleeping good when the preacher preaches. One day we're going to get you. We're going to have everybody leave the building. And then we're going to blow a horn. And you're going to wake up and think the rapture is taking place and you're left behind. We wouldn't do that. Christians sleeping and lifeless during the preaching time. Christians sleeping and lifeless when lost people are dying and going to hell every day. And my question is, you have a church here at one time, they must have been on fire for the Lord, and something happened and their reputation is, well, we're still alive, but Jesus knows it's different, that they're actually dead now. And my question is, how in the world can the church be dead, and how in the world can the church be asleep when the Jesus that died for us is alive and he's working and he's moving every day? How can we be dead when Jesus is alive? Hallelujah. He said, be alert, be awake. And what was the remedy? What was the remedy Jesus gave this church for them to wake up and experience a revival spiritually in their life again? Here's what Jesus said. It's real simple. He says, first of all, you just got to wake up. You got to wake up. You got to wake up. You got to wake up and look around and see what's going on. Wake up to the things of God. Don't be so focused on the things of the world. Be focused on the things of God. Wake up, he said. And then he says this right here. Then strengthen what remains and is about to die. Now that passage right there, that gives me some hope, because he says strengthen what remains and is about to die. Evidently there was still a little glimmer of hope. There was still a little flame burning there evidently. It was about to die, but it hadn't quite died yet. And Jesus is telling him, listen, whatever that is, you get over there and you fan that thing and you get that flame going again and let's get going for God. Strengthen it. Strengthen that fire. Strengthen that passion. Strengthen that zeal for the Lord before it dies. You know what Jesus was saying? He was saying to this church, he said, you know what? There's still hope for resurrection. He says, you're not completely dead yet. There's still hope. It's not over for you. It's never too late for revival. There's still time for you to strengthen yourself. There's still time for you to hold to what God is wanting to do in your life. There's time for you to repent and get back to the deeds that are unfinished. Jesus said there's some deeds that are unfinished. He tells them this in his letter. But what encourages me, it reminds me that he says this, and strengthen yourself and what remains and is about to die. That tells me that there's still a work God has for your life. Do you hear me? There's still a work that God has for this church. There's still a purpose for you. There's still a purpose for this church. And it's time for us to wake up and get on fire again for the things of God. It's not time to relax. It's not time to chill out. It's not time to coast. Jesus is saying it's time to get the fire flame going again and get strong in the Lord with a passion for him. We're living in the last days and we need to be on fire for the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Lord, help us. Evidently, this church in Sardis had lost their spiritual strength and their life. They were lifeless because one reason why is they had stopped doing some things. They stopped doing some things. The Bible says it. Jesus said in this letter, you have some unfinished deeds. Some of the translations say you have stopped doing this work in the sight of my God. This church here was once on fire, and I'm not trying to pick on our church tonight. I'm talking about the church in general, but you let the word hit the heart. He says, there's some things, you were on fire one time, but there's some things that you used to do that you no longer do anymore, and they're unfinished. Deeds that you used to do, but you no longer do them anymore. This church that was once on fire and this church that was strong, what happened? Well, I'll tell you what happened. They became a used to church. They became a used to church. You know what? They used to read their Bible. They used to read their Bible and spend time in the Word of God every day so they could hear the voice of God and know the will of God for their life. They used to do that. But they're no longer doing that. They've stopped those deeds. They used to be a church that would gather for prayer so they could draw near to the presence of God. They used to be a church that worshiped in spirit and truth. They used to be a church that would witness to the lost and tell people what Jesus had done in their life. They used to work in the church, but not no more. They are a used to church. And Jesus said that the remedy to come to life again, the remedy that you need to come alive again, he says in this letter, he says, remember therefore what you received and heard and hold to it and repent. In other words, he says this right here, if you want to come back to life again, you need to remember the things that you've heard, the things that you hold to, and you need to obey it and you need to repent. You need to go back to the things that you know. Now that word remember means this right here. It means to recall. It means to rethink some things. It means to go back. And Jesus was saying, if you're going to come back to life, you need to go back to the basics and you need to hold on to it. We make Christianity and serving God, we make it so complicated. And Jesus is saying this right here. If you want to come back to life spiritually and you want to be on fire for God and you want to have a fervor and a passion for God, here's what you need to do. You need to remember and go back to those things and you need to hold to them. You need to go back to the truth of God's word and hold to it. You need to go back to prayer and hold to it. You need to go back to praising God in your life every day and hold to it. Go back to your first love. Hold to it. Go back to when you were first saved and hold to it. Go back to serving and hold to it. Go back to church and hold to it. Friend, these things are simple, but they're vital to keep you on fire for the Lord. And I warn you tonight, like Jesus warned these people in this letter, that if you fail to go back and strengthen yourself and hold to those things that you have heard and the things that you know and have received, if you fail to strengthen yourself in those things and hold to them, and you let the fire of God burn out in your life, sooner or later you're going to backslide. Sooner or later, you're going to backslide. I don't care who you are. I don't care if you're the pastor. I don't care if you're a deacon. I don't care if you just were recently saved. It doesn't matter who you are. If you refuse to hold on to these things and go back to them and strengthen yourself in them and you let the fire of God go out in your life, I'm telling you, you're setting yourself up to backslide. And you will slowly, like the song Casting Crowns, there will be a slow fade. And you will fade away, and next thing you know, you'll be right back into old ways of living your life. And the sad part about it is I've seen it time and time again. Seen it time and time again. And the truth is this, it could happen to any of us. I don't care who you are. It could happen to all of us. You stop reading your Bible, you stop praying, you stop coming to church and fellowshipping with other believers, you stop serving, you stop coming to church and hearing the Word of God being preached, you stop worshiping together. Listen, you will drift away from the Lord and spiritually you will start to die. And Jesus said this right here. He says the remedy to stop that from happening is you need to go back to what you know. Go back to your Bible. Go back to your prayer life. Go back to worship. Go back to serving. Go back to Jesus. Go back to Jesus. Go back to being with Jesus. Go back to seeking to be filled with the Holy Spirit in your life. Go back to pursuing after a fresh fire and fervor in your life. How many of you want to be alive and on fire for God? Raise your hand. Come on. We all want it. Listen, if you desire that, then go back. Go back. And go back to the things you know. and hold to them. Hold to them. Don't let nothing pull you away from them, because if you get pulled away from these things right here, you are going to lose your passion, you're going to lose your fire, and you're going to look like you're alive, but I'm going to know on the inside it is nothing but just death. Dead, nothing. Lord, help me. That was the first point. Sardis was a soul church. I'm going to move quickly. Sardis was a soul church. They were a sleeping church and a soul church. Jesus said, in this church, some of you have allowed the filth of the world to soil your garments. But I love what he said here. Just this three-letter word. Thank God a few kept their garments from being soiled by the filth of this world. In other words, there was a remnant there in that church in Sardis that refused to allow themselves to be soiled by the filth of the world. You know, the Bible teaches us that once we give our life to the Lord, we're saved, born again, however you want to say it. Once that happens, there's a process called sanctification. We teach that in my Connections class. That process of sanctification really means that, really, it basically comes down to this. You start growing in holiness. And to make it even plainer than that, what it really means is that you just become more and more like Jesus every day of your life. How many of you want to be more and more like Jesus every day of your life? Well, that's the process of sanctification. Sanctification, in our manual, as we teach it, is more and more victory over sin in your life every day. How many of you want more and more victory over sin in your life every day? I want more and more victory over sin in my life every day. And God wants us to have more and more victory over sin in our life every day. God has a desire for his people to live a sanctified life. God has a desire for his people to live a holy life. He never wants us to allow ourselves to be sold by the filth and the corruption of this world. Listen to me, please. Jesus knew, speaking to this church, he knew that holiness was vital to their spiritual life. He knew that holiness was vital to their spiritual temperature. Listen, you mess with filth and the fire in your life is going to go out. You dabble in the filth and the fire is going to fizzle out. And I know that we live in a world today. Believe me, I know it. I hear it all the time. I know we live in a world today that wants to say that it's okay to live in sin. But Jesus clearly tells us that as believers, we're to come out from among them and we're to be separate. Hallelujah. We do not have to be like the world to win people to Jesus Christ. And my prayer is that God help us at Mount Olive First PH Church, that we would be part of the few. We would be the few in the last days. There's a movie, The Few Good Men. Let us be the few in these last days that are pursuing after sanctification, that are pursuing after holiness and seeking to be more and more like Jesus every day of our life. Come on, do you desire that? Come on, I desire that in my life. I desire it for our church. When I was in the Navy, man, I remember, seems like yesterday sometimes, but it was not. 1900s. I was in the United States Navy, and on certain occasions, we would have to dress out in dress whites. Anybody seen the sailors in dress whites before? A lot of times, if we were going into a port and it was in another country, our commanders would have us to line the outer part of the ship, and all of us would stand at parade rest, and we would be in our dress whites. And before you would go to stand outside and go into that port in those dress whites, there would be an inspection made. And the commander would come, and he would line all of you up, and he'd get in your grill, and he would just kind of look you over all over, and he would be looking at your dress whites, making sure there was no stains, nothing on them. And we hated that. You'd hate somebody all up in your grill inspecting you, right? And the reason people hated that was because you put those dress whites on in the morning time, and you got to go to breakfast, And you're doing all these activities before you get out there, and you're just so careful what you touch. You're paying attention to what you come near. I mean, you don't want any dirt. You don't want anything to stain those dress whites, because if he inspects you and they do not meet satisfaction, well, there's going to be some consequences to pay. And so you pay careful attention to everywhere you go, to everything you touch. And that needs to be the way we are as the church. We need to walk around in our dress whites, and we need to be careful everything that we allow to come near us. We need to be careful for the things that we try to get near and maybe touch or do not touch. We need to pay attention to the things around us, and we need to make sure we keep our garments from getting soiled by the filth of this world. Can I get an amen? We need to pay attention, and we need to live a holy life, pleasing unto God, becoming more and more like Jesus every day. If you want to come on and have Caleb come, or whoever's going to come and play, that'll be fine. The last thing I want to tell you here is Sardis was a standing church. They're a sleeping church, they're a soul church, but they're also a standing church. Let me explain why. Jesus said in this letter at the very end, he says, to the one who is victorious, his name will be confessed before the Father. Listen, when we make the decision to walk and pursue after God with our life, and we stand victorious and unashamed of Jesus, he says, I'm going to confess you to my Father and the angels. Don't you want Jesus to confess your name? That means he's going to say your name. He's going to say your name. And Jesus, when I read that verse right there, and he says, when you come to him, victorious, unashamed, that he's going to confess your name before his Father, I'm always reminded of that verse in Luke where Jesus said this right here. He says, if anyone is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his glory and in the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. I don't want Jesus to be ashamed of me, do you? I don't want him to be ashamed. And I don't want to be ashamed of him. And evidently this church, somewhere along the way, I don't know how it all happened, we don't know, but somewhere along the way, they got their eyes off of Jesus. And they lost their boldness. They lost their witness. They lost their love for Christ. And they had this reputation. But the reality is they had no spiritual influence at all in their culture. They were dead. They had a dead testimony and they had a dead religion. I don't want either one. I don't want a dead testimony and I don't want a dead religion. I don't want to come in here and all of us just go through motions and us deny that God has power to change people's lives. God help us to be a victorious church, and that we would stand for Christ. There was a few here that stood. God help us to stand for Christ unashamed, unashamed. I'm not going to be ashamed. Look what he did for me on the cross, died for me so my sins could be forgiven. Look how he's transformed my life, your life. No, I'm not going to be ashamed of him. I want to stand for him. I want to stand for him no matter how much pressure the world puts on us, no matter how much persecution comes. I want to be able to stand for my Lord. I want to have the testimony that Paul had when he says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because this is the power of God for the salvation for everyone who believes. Don't you want to have that testimony? We need to be alive. We need to stand. We need to be victorious. Listen, we're living in a day, and I'm not, I know I've said this many times, and I promise you, if I'm doing anything at all, I promise you, I'm not trying to scare anybody by any means. I'm just trying to prepare you. Please hear me. Whether it's somebody down the road behind this pulpit, I don't know how all will work. God knows the details going forward in this place and in this ministry. But let me tell you this right here, friend. I'm here to warn you and tell you and prepare you that no matter, and there's pressure coming. There is pressure that's going to come. There's going to be some persecution and things we're going to experience in our culture right here in America. I'm telling you, be ready for it. But let's listen to me. Don't be dead. Stand. stand and be unashamed and give glory to God for all that He's done in your life. Don't be ashamed of Him. Help us be that church that will be alive. I want the reality to be in our church that they are alive, that they are standing, they are bold, they're not ashamed. And it's time for us to wake up and be on fire. It's time to wake up and be clean. It's time to wake up and leave sin. And it's time to wake up and be bold. Listen, it's time to wake up and be all in for Jesus. It's not going to work going forward, one foot in the world and one foot in the church. No, you need to make up your mind. I'm all in or I'm out. Wow. A church alive is on fire and is never ashamed of the gospel. That's the reality. A church alive is always seeking to be filled with the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit. Listen, when pressure comes, you are not going to be able to do it on your own. You are going to need to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. He says, "You shall receive power and you will be my witness." It won't be in your own strength, my strength. It's going to be a strength that can only come from God. So let me ask you this before we pray. What's the reality? What's the reality? Not the reputation. What's the reality in your life tonight? What's the reality? I mean, I know from looking on the outside, man, I would say, hey, these folks here are on fire. They're here on Wednesday night. But what's the reality? Have you been asleep spiritually? Have you drifted away from God? Have you forgot those basics that Jesus said hold on to? Have you neglected them? Do you feel like there's just a dryness and there's no fire, there's no passion? You don't have to lift your hand tonight, but I want to just take the next few minutes, and I'm asking every one of you to join me. And let's come here at the front of this altar and let's just ask for the next few minutes that the Holy Spirit would give us power and that we would have passion and fire and we would be unashamed and we will stand. No matter what happens around us, we're going to stand. I don't want the reputation. I want the reality to be that Jeff Dale is on fire for Jesus. Don't you want that for your life? How about standing with me right now? And every one of you that can and able and feel comfortable doing so, just make your way to the altar just for the next few seconds. Come on, just join us right around the altar here. Make room for one another. Come with a heart that wants to be filled with the Holy Spirit. I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Come on, make that your prayer as you come. I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. I don't want to just go through the motions. I don't want to be a lifeless. I don't want to be dead. I want to be alive in Christ Jesus. I want the power of God. Hallelujah. I want the power of God. I want the fire of God. I want the fervor. I want it, Lord. I want the zeal of the Lord. Lord, I pray right now, Lord, over everyone that's coming to this altar, God. Their heart be filled with the Holy Spirit right now in the name of Jesus. Come on, friend. Just hold your hand out like you're going to receive something right now. Come on, just open it up. Open yourself up right now in the name of Jesus. I pray, Holy Spirit, fill your people. Fill every life here. Fill every heart here, God. Fill them, Lord. Fill them. Fill them, Lord, from their head to their toe, Lord, right now. Empower them in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, anoint them. Anoint them, oh God. Anoint them, oh God. I pray, Lord, for supernatural strength right now, God. Lord, I pray you would fan a flame inside of every one of them right now. Lord, we rebuke lukewarm people. We rebuke coldness. We want the fire of God. Fire and glory of God fall on every person here tonight. Fire of God, fall, fall. The glory of God, fall, fall, Lord. Fall on me. Fall on me. Fall on me. Lord, I declare it right now, Lord. Lord, I pray, God, every heart be opened. Every life be receptive right now. Lord, we declare to you we could care less about reputation. We want the reality to be, God, that we're on fire for you. God, there's a passion for you. Lord, in the name of Jesus, come on, pray with me, church. pray right there where you are. Just say, fill me, Holy Spirit, fill me. Come on, say, fill me, Holy Spirit. Fill me, fill me, fill me tonight. Fill me, fill me. Baptize me right now. I receive it. I receive right now the power of God. I receive right now the baptism with the Holy Spirit. I receive, I receive. Oh, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, do it, Lord. Holy Spirit, do it. We welcome you here now. Feel people. Feel them, Lord. Feel them, Lord. Feel them. Feel them. Make us unashamed, Lord. Lord, your word says that the power of God will come. The Spirit of God will give us boldness. God, give us boldness. And help us to go back. Help us to go back. Come on, right there where you are. Hold on to the things that Jesus said go back to. Hold on to the Bible, God's word. Hold on to your prayer life. Hold on, friend. You're going to be victorious if you'll hold on. If you'll hold on, you're going to be victorious. Hold on to praying. Hold on to praise. Hold on to preaching. Hold on to being together with God's people. Hold on, friend. Hold on. And you will be victorious in the name of Jesus. And you will overcome. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Yes, God. Come on, sing it, brother. Let's join with him.
Fill me up.
Come on, make that your prayer.
Fill me up, God.
Yes.
Fill me.
Come on. Fill us, Lord.
Fill
Hallelujah.
Me up, oh. Fill me.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Fill me.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Fill me.
Come on, lay your hands on your neighbor's shoulder right now and begin to pray for your neighbor. Come on. Place your hand on your neighbor's shoulder right now and begin to pray with them. Pray with them. Find somebody to pray with. Come on, just pray. Pray they be filled. Pray they be filled. Pray they be filled. Oh, hallelujah. Yes, God. Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus. Feel them, God. Feel them, God. Feel them, God. Feel them, God. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Yes, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, God, feel them, God, feel them, God. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you, God, thank you, God, thank you, God, thank you, God, thank you, Jesus, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, God. Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus.
Till I overflow.
Yes, God.
I want to run over.
Yes, God.
I want to run over. Fill me up.
Fill me up, Lord.
Until I overflow.
Yes, God.
I want to run over.
Yes,
I want to run over.
Yes, God.
Oh, fill me up.
That's our prayer.
Until I overflow.
Yes, God.
I want to run
Hallelujah.
Over. I want to run
Hallelujah.
Over. Oh, fill me up, God.
Yes.
Until I overflow.
Fill us, God.
I want to run over. I want to run over. Oh, fill me up.
Thank you, Jesus.
Until I overflow.
Yes, God.
I want to run over. I want to run over.
Yes.
Oh, fill me up.
Thank you,
Till
Jesus.
I overflow, I want to run
yes,
over. I want to run. Oh, fill me up, God. Fill me up.
Yes, God.
Fill me up.
Yes, right now.
God.
Right now.
Fill
right
me
now.
Up.
Come on, right now.
Fill
yes.
me up.
Hallelujah.
God. Fill me.
Come on, church,
up,
just begin to praise
God.
Him right now.
Fill
me up, Lord. Hallelujah. Yes, God.
God.
Yes, God.
Fill me.
Yes, God.
Up.
Thank you, Jesus. Oh, I receive right now, God. I receive right now, God. Father, thank you. Thank you for your Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you for your work. Thank you for your power. I pray right now, God, over everyone here. God, that you would just fill every one of us afresh. We walk out of these doors with fresh passion, fresh fire, fresh fervor, zeal for you, God, that will flow into our families, flow into the people around us. God, I refuse to have a reputation of being alive, but on the inside, I'm really dead. No, Lord, I'm asking you right now to do heart surgery on me. Do heart surgery on me right now. God, I pray right now, fire come. Just begin to work right now in my heart. Come on, fire, work right now in my heart. Come on, glory of God, work right now in my heart. Oh, God, in my heart, in my heart. Stir the flame, fan the flame, oh, God. Do it in me, God. Do it in me, Lord. I declare it, God, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Come on, let's give God praise and glory. Amen, amen. Listen, I'm going to just tell you to obey the Lord.
Thank you so much for joining us online today.
Just be obedient to God. The altar's open. If you want to stay around and just pray,
please let us know.
Do whatever the Lord leads you in. But God bless you all. Thank you.
To give or to learn more about our church, go to mofphc.org or you can download our app. Thank you again for joining us, and we want you to know that we love you and that we're praying for you. Have a blessed week.